for showing up today and joining. Oops. And joining us for tonight. We're super excited to have this event. Unfortunately, SALDEF was not able to join us tonight, but we still encourage you to check out their website and all the great things that they're doing. And to start off, I'd like to hand it off to the panelists to introduce themselves with their name, pronouns, the organization they represent, and their answer to the icebreaker question, which is, who is your favorite insect? Darren, do you want to kick us off? Or Sunny, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, sorry about that. I'm Sunny Liu. I am a co-founder of Xinsheng Project, previously known as WeChat Project, before we had an IP law issue. I use she, they pronouns. I am based right now out of Houston, Texas's Asia town. And I honestly couldn't think of a favorite bug, but I will say that the bug that likes me the most, unfortunately, are mosquitoes. I get eaten alive in swamp weather over here down in the south. I don't know if Nick or Darren, y'all want to go next.
I can go. Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. So I am Nick. Pronouns are he, him. I'm in Palo Alto, California, and my favorite bug is crayfish because they are delicious. All right. I think Darren is up.
Cool. Thank you. Hi, all. My name is Darren. Preferred pronouns are they, them, theirs. I'm based in Harlem, New York City. I work with the Movement Cooperative as a senior data scientist. The TMC, really briefly, is an organization that supports progressive organizations around data infrastructure and also research, which is what I do. Bugs honestly give me the heebie-jeebies, but if I had to pick one, the great pollinator, gotta love the bumblebee.
Thank you so much. And I am Michelle Nguyen. I am part of the policy team with Amplify Asian America, and I will be your moderator for tonight. I use she, her pronouns, and my favorite bugs are roly-polies or potato bugs because they curl up and they're so cute. I don't like touching them, but they look cute. So we're super excited tonight for this lively discussion about disinformation in our Asian American community. We wanted to emphasize that we are aiming to center the discussion around Asian American youth and young adults in particular. So any perspectives or insight into how disinformation impacts this group specifically, or the unique role that it plays in combating disinformation would be especially interesting to raise up during our discussion today. For the attendees, if you have any questions for the panelists, please put them into the chat and we will read them out loud during our Q&A session. If you'd be more comfortable sending that in anonymously, please send either Raul or Joey a private message and they will handle those questions for me. And then to get started here with our first question for our panel, and feel free to popcorn after you're done with your answer. In the course of your and your organization's work, what kind of issues have come up for you with disinformation? What are the larger issues and specific ones to the communities that you work in? Darren, do you want to kick us off?
Yeah, I don't have too long of an answer. I'm actually pretty sure that Vincent and Sunny will have a much more thorough answer. For us, doing the research, one of the things that my team, when we first started kind of looking at disinformation, we really just want to start off by trying to figure out like what even information is out there. We recognize that there's that for some organizations, disinformation is challenging just because messaging is hard. It's like, just as when it comes to messaging around voter turnout, right? There are clear things that have shown to work from research. For instance, social pressure works, and then the RCN messages recently. RCN jargon giraffe. RCN stands for race class narrative. When we explicitly talk about race, that works in a universal framing. And so we wanted to see like what are the kind of are there things about messaging that helps? But then as we did kind of a larger literature review and kind of started diving in, I recognized that a lot of this work around disinformation really dovetails actually my own personal research around emotions and feelings. Disinformation is really as much as about like just cognitive facts, as much as about feelings and emotions, and ways that we can tackle these questions through messaging, but also through the way we are organizing with each other and networking with each other. But yeah, I maybe that's as a top level, I'll start there. I'm so certain that Sunny and Vincent are gonna have much more better gems than I do at this point. So maybe I'll just popcorn to Sunny. How does that sound?
Yeah, sure. So again, I'm representing Xinsheng Project, previously known as WeChat Project. We work specifically with fighting disinformation among the Chinese diaspora on platforms like WeChat that are really popular. And for just in case like anyone doesn't know what WeChat is, it is probably the most popular social media network for the Chinese migrant community. And it's not just a social media app. It sounds like it could just be like, you know, like a Facebook or a Twitter, but it's like, if you can imagine, you didn't have it, like these separate venues where there's like CNN or New York Times, Twitter and Facebook all as like separate things, but rather have all of them as one app. That's really what WeChat is. And the reason for this is because the CCP, the Chinese government, bans using things like Facebook and Twitter in China. And because a lot of people who are especially part of the diaspora community still have connections back to China and the mainland China, then they in turn want to keep in touch with their family and friends there, and they will then use WeChat. And so that is why WeChat has become this like all-in-one hub for getting news, for communicating with your community, also for organizing. I think that it's a really dangerous place in that it often becomes a petri dish of disinformation and incubates a lot of radicalization. And a lot of this is because you have to remember it's a phone app, right? And so if you're looking at things on your phone, you probably don't want to read very nuanced, in-depth, like multi-page articles and analysis of political issues. You'll probably just see a headline and then maybe like see a few sensationalized videos, and that's it. And the other big issue is that specifically among the Chinese diaspora community and the Chinese American community, there is like a very singular perspective on WeChat. So the way that news on WeChat works is that it's like if your cousin posted a rant on Facebook and that was just treated as news, that often just happens on WeChat because it becomes people's news platform, but it's not like a place where trained journalists who have been told that they need to fact check everything. There's no regulation of what information is considered news or not. And so anyone's thoughts can just become news. Unfortunately, the way that this happens is through microblogs or official accounts, as they're called. And there are 65 conservative ones. And a lot of these are like very right wing versus less than 3 progressive ones on the other side. And so you can kind of see that it's very asymmetrically polarized to one direction. And while a lot of these right wing narratives and disinformation influence all Chinese Americans and Chinese migrants on the app, they really have a pronounced effect on the most marginalized among our community, recent migrants, elderly, people who don't speak English, because they don't have very limited access to reputable news sources in their mother tongue. And so I think that like specific, I guess, to the Chinese diaspora is really the fact that everything really happens on WeChat. Kind of fun fact that's kind of sad, infamously, WeChat has not only mobilized Chinese Americans against things like affirmative action, such as California's Proposition 16 last year, but also crowdfunded donations to the Proud Boys after the storming of the US Capitol. So it is a very powerful platform for sure. And we're trying to push it to the other side to use the power for good.
So I think that's my turn, right? So I am So I start in the Vietnamese American community. I think there are a couple really interesting features. One is that the vast majority of Vietnamese American immigrants really started in 1975 with the fall of Saigon. So we had, you know, a bulk of largely professionals that helped the US government and were allowed to escape in the first group of 130,000. And then a larger like kind of like group that came in the 80s that were escaping re-education camps and sort of mistreatment at the hands of the communist government of Vietnam. And so the Vietnamese community is very interesting in that the older generation has lower English proficiency, I believe the lowest in all AAPI groups, and very strong anti-communist sort of sentiments. Though if you would ask someone how to define communism, it really comes out a lot more like authoritarianism than anything that you would recognize in like a political science piece, right? And so there's not a lot of civics understanding. It's not unique to the, you know, to the Vietnamese American population, but it's compounded by like sort of a generational divide with the second generation Vietnamese Americans who are less proficient in Vietnamese, who many of them have great educations. But there's like when you combine that with sort of the typical like Asian American, like sort of expectation of deference to elders, it really makes these conversations very difficult. And particularly in my community, around the murder of George Floyd, there was a lot of misinformation around structural racism and attitudes on police. The Vietnamese American, so the other issue is really around our media. So first of all, like Vietnamese American professional media doesn't really exist in Vietnamese language. That is like anything that will cover like complex political topics because they just avoid it. Our community is actually very similar to the Cuban American community, where red baiting and sort of tagging things as communist really can elicit like an emotional, irrational response. And so, you know, our goal is to try to bring this information to our community. So right now, in terms of technology platforms, of course, Facebook is a part of it, but actually YouTube. YouTube plays an outsider's role. So YouTube's, you know, own user researchers might look at YouTube as like our average, you know, if you look at like their analytics, you know, average YouTube video is like 5 minutes long. For the Vietnamese American community, I suspect it's closer to an hour. We have talking heads that are basically like Alex Jones, like people who are copying verbatim these folks that have been banned in English, but continue to proliferate on YouTube in Vietnamese. And we've been engaging with the tech platforms because essentially their indifference is straight up racist. So we've been, you know, really working on a campaign to really embarrass some of these platforms into action. So just a long story short, making information available in Vietnamese, it's not as simple as just translating Vox, because Vox is aimed at a very different audience. So we really work on like writing self-contained explainer content in both Vietnamese, in English first, because the people in our community who are experts in US politics write in English and then translate into Vietnamese. So that not only can Vietnamese Americans like understand like the issues that they're voting on, but also the elements of the platforms. And so we're really an education project. It's been really interesting. I think Vietnamese Americans in general are really interesting because we pull as a group, like very liberal on gun control, on healthcare and on climate change, and slightly conservative on issues like abortion. But the entire like sort of like, you know, Democrats are weak on foreign policy, defense and communism, like kind of like blinds people to from voting on issues that actually affect them day to day. And so we're working a lot to like even just like set straight the historical record that is based in sort of lies and misunderstanding. So anyway, that's our project in a nutshell.
Michelle, is it okay if I kind of responded to something? There's something that Sunny both Sunny and Nick mentioned that like I really want to emphasize, which is the way disinformation works. Well, what disinformation can anybody is susceptible to disinformation, and the way when it comes to disinformation, it is a feeling process, and often there are certain feelings that are stickier than others, and can really insert itself as a result. So for instance, like when Nick talked about communism as a word, right? That it's an angering motion for folks, at least if I'm in my community, I have my ties that go back to Hong Kong. So anything CCP is like, it triggers. And what ends up happening is those feeling, that stickiness of anger also sticks onto other disinformation. So disinformation not just George Floyd, but also the Republican Party and how awesome they are, or like Trump, like all these things, like it ends up getting stuck together. And it starts with a seed of like an anger, and then everything kind of just blows up and finds truth. When it comes to social media, YouTube and I just want to actually emphasize why YouTube and Facebook and these tech companies are so dangerous for our communities. They profit off of essentially selling anger, right? They're anger profiteers. And the way it works is they sell ads, and in order to get ads, they rely on user content that that essentially generates anger. And with anger, people might like go through spirals, doom spirals, right? Doom scrolling, of more YouTube content, et cetera. And the more YouTube content folks consume, the more ads that they essentially sell, right? And so there is very little incentive for tech companies to stop some of this disinformation because it makes them money.
This is why embarrassment has been very effective.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. I was just going to add that the other feeling I think someone mentioned in the chat too, is not just like anger, that I think these people who might be pushing out disinformation to our communities really are good at capitalizing on, but they are also really good at capitalizing on fear and panic. I think especially within the past year with things like the Black Lives Matter protests that led to a lot of, unfortunately, anti-Black responses from Asian diaspora communities. It was like often stemmed out of capitalizing on people's fears that like they like left their home countries that might have had a very chaotic background, and then like they moved to America for this idea of stability, and then this idea of stability gets shaken, and then they then just blame it on Black Americans when really that should not be what they're pointing their fingers should be at white supremacy. But I think that the right is really good at capitalizing on any sort of fear and telling people who to blame it on among our communities. I think I've also seen that, for example, kind of weirdly with like anti-Asian violence. I think especially with the rise of anti-Asian sentiment and xenophobia during the pandemic, a lot of our communities, and speaking specifically to the Chinese diaspora community, they have been like, I feel like we can see that a lot of times they definitely feel this palpable sense of fear and panic over how US-China tensions might affect their lives as people who have nothing to do with the CCP. Often many of them dislike the CCP and left and came here because they dislike the CCP, but anytime people see them, they see them as the enemy, because once America's portrayed the CCP as an enemy, I guess like anyone who looks vaguely Chinese, including other East Asians or Southeast Asian folks, often get painted as the enemy too. But then what the right has been so great at doing on spaces like WeChat is then pointing the blame not at politicians amping up a lot of these tensions, or a lot of people who are white supremacists and calling for things like anti-Asian violence, but blaming like singular perpetrators who the news often show as Black or brown. So then that just fuels the anti-Blackness that they really might have had a heightened sense of because of the protests last summer. So it's a spiral of anger, fear, panic. I don't know if you've seen that too, Nick, in the Vietnamese diaspora.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a former technologist. I'm a recovering technologist. And I think the joke I always say is that not enough of us studied Maslow to understand that fear is the easiest thing to monetize, right? And so I think it's really, you know, we evolved to exist in like small, like groups of like dozens of people. And so like if your buddy in a hut next to you like got eaten by a tiger, it makes sense to be scared of tigers, right? And bad things happen. Now we have a system that anything that can happen in a global population of 7 billion people can get amplified. Some of it might actually be a real thing that happened. Is it a thing that you should be scared of? Probably not. But, you know, it triggers that same sort of like primal sort of like self-preservation instinct. And the issue here is also that just with this attention economy, you know, mathematicians create these algorithms that like put you on this treadmill. And so it's not like as simple as a bunch of evil people laughing in a room saying like, let's turn up the dial on right-wing stuff. It's like, if you have no responsibility to the truth, you can keep fine-tuning your messaging. And you start, you know, watching a video like that you think gives you some comfort about COVID not being as bad as it seems. And it gets you all, you know, eventually through recommendations to like the vaccine is a lie, right? And so, and that's really harmful. So yeah, I'm just long-winded way of saying I agree very, very thoroughly.
Thank you for that discussion. Speaking of sources of disinformation, where do you feel like is the biggest source for young adult Asian Americans, sources of like disinformation that we should be aware of? And how do we begin to fight that disinformation? Anybody can take the question.
Well, I'll start. So I think for us, we've been pretty lucky in that the younger generation of Vietnamese Americans, I think, consume like most mainstream content. So there are certainly people that like, will read something on Fox or something more like right-wing than that, right? Infowars or whatever. But the vast majority of people that we're seeing in the younger generation, I think, are really concerned about like sort of the misinformation that's really affecting community. And so one thing has been really inspirational working on our project, seeing so many young Vietnamese people raising their hands and offering to chip in. So I think for us, it's like, you know, we're trying to build more trust between generations so that a core part of our strategy is just to say like, hey, the person that fixes your iPhone might be able to help you, like that you know in real life might be able to help you figure out if this is a lie, right? And just try to create more trust in the community. Certainly, you know, there are closed groups on Facebook that like sort of amplify, but what we've seen is that, you know, I think young Vietnamese Americans that are affected by disinformation and kind of in conspiracy theories are just in the mainstream English language channels, right? The Proud Boy groups, the Boogaloo groups or whatever. So, and less so like, you know, specific Vietnamese specific groups.
I would echo Nick on that. I will say that a big lesson that the Xinsheng Project has, similar to Viet Fact Check, I think when we started, it was really a group of mostly like for one and a half or second generation or later Chinese Americans who realized that a lot of their parents or grandparents were seeing a lot of disinformation in spaces like WeChat. And similar to Viet Fact Check, like realizing that, hey, like these political discussions are so hard to have, but maybe they would be more easy to have if it came from someone you already like love and trust, such as a family member, your son, your daughter, your grandchild, etc. But at the same time, I think through working more among Chinese diasporic spaces, not just on WeChat, but like on the English social media platforms, where we did not intend to really have a platform there, but some of our content picked up steam. I think that it showed us that unfortunately, a lot of, I don't know if whether or not we should call it disinformation, but just a lot of people, including our own peers, could be more skeptical in whatever they consume. So I don't think there's necessarily a singular source, but just to be wary of whatever source you're consuming. And I think for a lot of young Asian Americans, we spend a lot of time, especially like in the millennial or Gen Z generations where we grew up with internet, we spend a lot of time online. And so we spend a lot of time on like social media apps, for example. And I think that especially from the political side of social media, like the infographic side of Instagram or political Twitter or even political TikTok, there are often things where it's like what Nick was describing earlier, where there might be something that seems innocuous, but it can lead you down a rabbit hole because of the technology companies trying to push videos that get you to spend more time on their apps. And so I think that that is something we've unfortunately seen. For example, we've seen a lot of younger folks unfortunately repeat a lot of the anti-Black sentiments that were really appearing. For example, in the height of the resurgence of Black Lives Matter protests last summer, and then kind of similarly to the older generation, that those sorts of anti-Black sentiments reappearing with anti-Asian violence and a lot of, including Asian media news sources, really honing in on the fact that like only really showing pictures of the perpetrators if they're like Black or brown and making that like the main picture you see before you click on a headline. And I think that that has been something I've been seeing a lot among our peers. But I don't know if it's coming from a singular source per se.
Yeah, I just plus like a million to everything that Sunny and Nick just mentioned. I do want to touch on, I guess, a couple of aspects around like the feelings things, especially for ourselves as we take care of ourselves in kind of dealing with the disinformation. I think it's easy. I think we're in a lot of ways in a uphill climb in fighting back a lot of this disinformation, and because at least what we've seen in the research in the literature is that status quo, if we're seeing in your social media feed, for instance, 50% of it is disinformation, 50% of it is facts, right? That as a universe isn't enough to push back. Even if it's like 51-49, right? It's not enough to push back, because what we see is if our feeds are so clogged with disinformation, what we've literature shows that folks just tend to say, oh, I don't know who's right, so we're not accepting we don't know what the fact is. And what ends up happening is disinformation rules the day in those circumstances. It's an uphill climb, we're trying to change behavior, right? Which is much more complex than just spreading disinformation. So I guess like one of the things that I want to touch on is the fact that given this uphill climb, this monumental task before us, we have to recognize that it can be taxing on us, and in order to fight back, but what we have to do is constantly repeat. One of the things that actually works with pushing back against disinformation is just being ridiculously and absurdly repetitive, because when it comes to facts and when it comes to these things, it's about familiarization. The more familiar a piece of information is, whether it's a disinformation or it's a fact, the more familiar it is. If it's coming from someone it makes it more familiar. If it's coming from a stranger, it makes it a little less familiar. If it's coming from like a big influencer, it makes it more familiar, right? If you repeat it, it becomes familiar, even if it's false, right? So we just have to keep repeating it. I just want to touch on the fact that I recognize how monumental this task is before us. But one of the best things that we can do is just be a broken record and just repeat it. One thing that Sunny and Nick mentioned around like there's no singular source, and I totally agree with them. One thing that I also want to touch on is like around specifically on YouTube. What I've been witnessing a lot is the use of essentially using essentially using news anchor like videos, right? Videos that make itself like seem like news, and this is a tactic Falun Gong uses a lot to spread their disinformation. It's actually surprisingly dangerous, because it's a way to make news, or rather disinformation, very familiar. It feels like it's coming from a very legitimate source, and it's coming from a folks that share the same anger and fear around the CCP, and it touches all these bells and triggers, and then attaches that disinformation onto the person. So I just want to highlight how, like, the note that other aspect of, like, the way these messages are being shared, and acting like they're very familiar friends with us, or familiar sources of information, as a way to just latch on disinformation to what we might to essentially our emotional worlds.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. And thank you, Darren, for that really great reminder to make sure we are taking care of ourselves, but also the importance of just repeating, and also the positionality of who is saying the news or the op-eds out there. Nick, I'm so happy that you wrote that one. I really love the piece that Nick shared from Viet Fact Check about how to talk to your loved ones about fake news. Back to the original question Michelle proposed, I was sitting here pondering it, and I actually remembered that the Xinsheng Project has unfortunately had multiple interactions with this group called AZN Identity, and they are mostly based in Reddit. I believe they have Twitter as well, and they are known for really incubating right-wing beliefs among specifically young Asian American men. Usually cisgender men, cisgender heterosexual men, and like a lot of, I guess, the incel community seems to also, there's like some Venn diagram in all of this. I put a paper in the chat that a person who knows a lot more about this topic, or a group of people who study this thoroughly know a lot more if you're curious, but the way that we've interacted with it is that for some context, Xinsheng Project is a collective of mostly young diasporic Chinese peoples, and we're all volunteers, and it happened, we did not intend necessarily for this to be the way, but it just happened that a lot of us were non-binary, or were women, and are femme identifying, and we have been harassed online by AZN Identity, and AZN Identity has done that to many other Asian American women and femme identifying individuals. For example, the author of Little Fires Everywhere, Celeste, was also similarly harassed. And AZN Identity is also known for harboring a lot of anti-Black sentiment, really liking to push the narrative of Black on Asian crime. And so I think that if we are to find a source where a lot of this information, is coming from, it is this Reddit thread / Twitter account. And it similarly preys upon fears, with a lot of the popular culture emasculating Asian American men. I think a lot of, at least the study points that maybe that is one reason why they have turned into these spaces where they feel like they have some sort of collective power, by blaming Asian American women for their quote unquote emasculated status in popular culture.
Nick, did you want to chime in, or?
Well, there was a question that someone put in about de-radicalizing, or someone changing someone's mind. I had an interesting story, so I wanted to share that real fast. If I can take that one on. Absolutely. I think what's been really interesting is like this like thread of like helping people, like trying to engage someone's sort of analytical mind, right? Like you can't change someone's mind overnight. Often arguments end up with a perception of a winner and a loser, and you can't really get there. You need to get to, so, you know, one of the first pieces we put out was really around media literacy and just how to understand fake news. Like to Darren's point, like, it's getting cheaper and cheaper to create content that's indistinguishable to most people from CNN or from Fox News, like whether it's web or video. And so really giving people some basic tips that kind of ends on a hopeful note of like, hey, you know, ask other people that you know in real life if these things are real or not, because you really, you know, trying to rebuild that like sort of social like relationships of real people that you know in real life to help, you know, help anchor you in reality. And so I think, you know, as I started to work on that, like, you know, my own father, who, you know, was the impetus for me joining, starting Viet Fact Check, you know, he came with a lot of like sort of like, you know, he did, like many refugees, I think that one thing that's really important to understand about the refugee experience is that from a marketing perspective, people chose the United States. They gave up everything to come to the United States. And the last thing you tell to someone when they let's say they, you know, sold everything and watched, you know, gave up everything to buy a new car, you don't tell them that car sucks, right? And that's the thing that like people don't really understand is like you have to like, so when you start talking about things like the police are corrupt, there are problems in this country, and you're talking to someone who literally watched their relatives die on a boat coming to the United States, it's going to fall on deaf ears, right? Because it's like, you know, you sound like you're kind of like criticizing it, like indirectly a choice that someone made. And so like my dad's reaction was that it can't be that bad. You know, America is great. I'm so grateful to this country for letting me in. And there was some adjacency to like sort of white supremacy that is internalized by Asian Americans that like, you know, we are the guests of quote unquote Americans, which is like kind of a synonym for white people. And so, you know, writing that piece and then talking a little bit more about like sort of the history of racism in the United States and how we've improved, right? That like, you know, trying to explain structural racism. I think there was a lot of repressed memory that my father had as a doctor in Columbus, Ohio, that like he just like couldn't deal with at the time, didn't have the language to relate, or not the language, didn't have the headspace. And so he just repressed it all. And so citing these examples of anti-Asian racism or anti-Black racism in the United States and how things have improved and how other groups like Black Americans have really fought tirelessly for all race, like for equality across all races, it really opened my dad's mind to like, oh, these interactions I had 30 years ago that kind of bothered me, I don't know why, that was racism. I just didn't have the time, I was feeding my family, I didn't have the time to think about it. And so like part of it is just pushing out that time horizon and say like, you don't have to convince someone overnight, but just like this drumbeat of like helpful content, right? Like, you know, we're like, if you look at the Viet Fact Check stuff, a lot of it is really just kind of reiterating kind of the accomplishments of the Obama administration with regards to TPP, with regards to relationships with Vietnam and China, that people just don't know because they only know these memes that are around like how Obama brought shame to the United States by embarrassing us in front of China, right? And so I think for me, like, you know, it, on one hand, like it's my dad, but on the other hand, changing the mind of your parent is really, really hard. So, you know, I think he really opened his mind. He's like, you know, I could vote for a Democrat. It doesn't make me a Democrat, right? And so, you know, we also try to adopt kind of this like Cronkite, like 80s media tone where we're like, here are facts that you need to know and you can make decisions, but we just want you to make decisions based on your own interests. So here are the different positions, make your own decision, right? Engage your analytical mind. Same thing with like claims on COVID. We're like, you know, hey, if the vaccine is really killing people, you know, here are the hundreds of millions of people that have been vaccinated. How many people do you know that are dying of the vaccine, right? How many people do you know that are affected by COVID? Just like plant that in their head so that so instead of like, you know, engaging the belief side of their intellect, it's really the analysis side, right? Like, you know, what if this is real, this belief is real, then what should I see in the world that would reinforce that versus what do I see on social media? And so, yeah, I mean, it's a small personal story, but it really felt good. The last thing I'll say is that or did I stop talking? Oh no.
I think we just got your audio back.
Oh yeah. We're back now. Sorry about that. Anyway, enough talking. I can pass it to anyone else who wants to talk.
Just to reiterate the question in case Sunny and Darren want to answer it as well. The question was, does anyone have stories of successfully de-radicalizing or at least somewhat changing someone's mind, like an elder in your family or in the community?
I think we did it at the same time. We unmuted at the same time. Darren, do you want to go first? Okay. I think I hear you mouthing, you go first. I think similar to Nick, my impetus for co-founding Xinsheng Project really came from my own family. Fortunately, I still have work to do with them. I think the complication with my family is not just a lot of the digital disinformation they're hearing, but they are devout Baptist Christians. And we're kind of roped into the church as the first community that they felt like were helpful and kind to them when they first immigrated to America almost 2 decades ago. And so unfortunately, this church is very openly and very extremely right-wing. And I think that the religious aspect of a lot of the radicalization is something that is also very fascinating. And I think it would be amazing if there were targeted efforts towards that. With Xinsheng Project's work though, I think that's a story that I find hope in personally is that a lot of times something we've realized is that we're like constantly on the defensive, right? Like inherently in fighting disinformation, you're responding to narratives that are already out there. But I think that's something we realized doing this at like the year mark is that instead of only responding and like always being on the fence, I think that one strategy that sometimes we just don't have capacity to, or because we're so busy trying to respond to the disinformation, we don't really set out the time and the space to create our own narratives for and be on the offensive in a way, like create these different narratives for people to maybe find hope in, or maybe funneling their very strong emotions to a different direction rather than just telling them that yes, they might be feeling hurt or angry, but they shouldn't be believing X, Y, or Z, but giving them a different alternative to believe in. I think that has been really helpful. We had a lot of good feedback. For example, we had an article that we put out that about what is the root behind anti-Asian violence and really urging people not to look at it as just individual attacks, but part of a larger issue of systemic racism, which also includes things like classism, right? Like a lot of times we have to ask ourselves, like, yes, we might be seeing these viral videos, but they make it really easy to forget like why the certain kinds of Asian Americans who are being attacked were so vulnerable in the first place. A lot of them are low income. A lot of them, for example, like the Atlanta shootings, because they're low income, they ended up in a trade that often unfortunately has a lot of violence, and can lead to also people pinning their Asian fetishization of Asian women on them, like the white shooter who killed, unfortunately, a lot of the women in Atlanta, or like a lot of the elderly who were being attacked were not only low income, but they didn't speak English. And so when, for example, like they were being attacked, they didn't know how to ask for help, right? Like a lot of times, for example, in the videos, you would see that even when 911 came, the 911 people would be helping the attacker and not the person being attacked because they simply have this language barrier. And a lot of that comes from also not just like immigration status, but maybe like a lot of them never had the financial resources to get an English lessons, right? And a lot of them end up living in ethnic enclaves, where a lot of them, because they live in these ethnic enclaves and the rent is affordable there, there are other people of their culture there, they don't have to learn English. But this also makes them very vulnerable to not just these individual attacks, but systemic violence that comes with, for example, not having affordable housing in America, and at a time when a lot of people have lost their jobs, and during the pandemic when a lot of people don't even have healthcare insurance, right? And so even if they get sick, they can't go to the doctor. And so thinking about not just, I guess, the individual attacks and like blaming, I guess, the singular perpetrators that might be showing on these viral videos or on news sources as like these mugshots of Black or brown people, but thinking about the structural issues, which often at the root of it is white supremacy, the structural issues behind what made the people who ended up attacked so vulnerable in the first place. And I think that that struck a nerve with a lot of people and made them kind of rethink a lot of how they were seeing the Stop API Hate movement as not just a movement to stop these singular attacks, but stop this larger systemic issues as well.
For myself, I noticed my little sis is in this call. Hey gnomes. My relationship with my conversations with my parents has been a decades long project, and it's not a short term project. It's not something that go in and I'm like, all right. I mean, at least when I first started it out, those conversations, they were much more angerful and it just backfired all the time. And I realized over time, as I was reading more and kind of actually researching and figuring out this process, and especially in the last couple of years, realized that there are like emotional work and emotional ways to engage with my parents. Some work better than others, and in a way, it's been experimentation along the way. For myself, what's worked really well recently. Is just a little peppering of facts here and there when it comes up, right? If it's healthcare, it's like remind them about a world where we can all get healthcare and that we don't have to get screwed around by pharmaceutical companies and insurance companies and hospitals, right? And remind them to their current situations great point, Nick, about Kelly and Brockman. When it comes to and then I've also like incorporated a lot of humor into the things. Like they'll say stuff, and I'll like have like these like humorous deflections and that's actually made the conversation more amenable to them, rather than just coming in and be like just straight up and trying to with my anger and what I've found, and actually the literature has shown this to be true, is that that anger often comes out as shaming, and it often backfires. Chef talks a lot about shame and pride in a lot of these conversations. And when we in our intonation and when we're coming in strong, it's a description of how much they're lacking or how much they feel inferior, et cetera. And even though we're not saying it, we might be implying it, even if we're not intentionally implying it. I've done a lot of just self-work in terms of controlling myself and the way I present myself in those. And then it's actually helped it being more humorous in that process or just being more factual. It's not a finished project, and I still, you know, I think there's still decades to go, but it's coming along.
Thank you, y'all, for that response. I'm actually going to go ahead and open it up to the audience to ask questions now. If you have any questions, feel free to use the reaction to raise your hand. Otherwise, I think Joey and Raul also received a couple of questions from the audience privately, so they can also chime in whenever they feel like it.
Yeah, happy to keep the conversation going here. One question we got is, what's been the most helpful resource, either, you know, an article, book, a tweet, a podcast? What's a helpful resource you've encountered that has really shaped how you think about disinformation? Would love it if any of the panelists have a response to that one.
For myself, so there are quite a few, but one that I want to really highlight is Damon Centola. I think that's how I might be mispronouncing the last name, Centola. Damon Centola writes about social networks. I don't remember the exact book name, but Santola has a really has an amazing analysis of how essentially information spreads by weak ties and how we can form strong ties in order to push back against disinformation. The book isn't necessarily about disinformation, but it touches on disinformation here and there. But the larger analysis about the importance of strong ties, building communities, and as well as having multiple points of reinforcement really helps the way essentially we can convince each other in terms of changing behavior. That book have been highly influential in the way I think. And I know that book, before it was published as a book, Santola had published multiple articles in the American Sociological Association's journal.
I'll break the uncomfortable silence. So I think for us, it's hard to say this without sounding, how to say it. We're trying really hard to create the content because it doesn't exist. I think a lot of my professional experience as a product manager, as an executive, I've led data science, design, engineering teams. And, I'm one of these like internet people that came of age where we just like thought clicks were the sole goal, and then people would act in their own self-interests. So I did my time as like kind of like thinking in terms of it, like being like a techno-libertarian, like saying like, oh well, people are just gonna act in their own interests, so this is fine, we just have to look at the numbers. And I spent a lot of time kind of really trying to fight what is a lot like global warming in tech, right? That like human-centered activity has really eroded the internet in a way that like allows for filter bubbles and echo chambers to be created. Economic forces and incentives are such that, like, I used to be a startup founder, and when I started my company in 2010, it was much easier to raise money on a random thing. Now today, I've seen like travel websites go under because Travelocity has $1 billion advertising budget. Like the established players in the markets that shouldn't be done by now have incredible, like unprecedented power to erase competitive narratives, conflicting narratives from existence. That's true in commercial activity. That's true in terms of information architecture. And so a lot of my sources are just doing this stuff for 20 years, right? And seeing firsthand the effect and engaging with executives at tech companies and seeing how they view the world, right? That if you're a professional trying to like make Facebook successful, you make a certain set of decisions that look exactly like the decisions that Facebook is making right now. And so like really thinking about, I've been to FTC, I've been to Department of Justice, like to talk about monopoly and monopolistic action. And I'm a big believer in government's role in aligning incentives so that it becomes existential for tech companies to say like, hey, we need to make the right decision because if we don't, we'll make less money because we'll get broken up, right? Or that like we need to replace the externalities, the impact on American society back onto companies. And so a lot of the work is like just, I'm in some ways I'm my own primary source. Of course, I'm informed by the people I've worked with, and I've really had the good fortune of managing teams that have had like social science PhDs that have educated me a lot on information and how it spreads. But I think a lot, my challenge is trying to take all this like sort of technical jargony information and really distill it down into like practical like advice and information that people can use to live their lives the way they want to live their lives.
Echoing Nick, I don't think, unlike Darren, I don't like study this for a living, right? I think my experience in trying to combat disinformation is running and starting Xinsheng Project. And so I think honestly, most of the things I've learned is not a very satisfying answer. It's like one for my kind of like Nick, like more my personal experiences of, I also grew up in that Baptist church that was right wing. And I also used to be right wing, but definitely went the other direction as the only one in my family who did and left the church. But I think like having firsthand experience is very helpful, especially because you can understand better where the other side is coming from. I think also honestly, like learning, I think while like it is important to like read studies on disinformation, I think honestly just understanding the audience is probably, I would say, the most important thing in terms of fighting it. Whether that be like understanding better where your parents are coming from or where the elders in your community are coming from or even your peers. So I think that a lot of that has come from like taking Asian American studies classes and also like history of like modern Asia, like essentially what happened in the continent of Asia in the 20th century has led so many people to migrate elsewhere. And like, how did those migration patterns influence how they might be thinking, like kind of like what Nick was saying about how a lot of Vietnamese Americans are very staunchly anti-communist and like thinking about that history of like what led them to become refugees in the first place was a communist government. And so that makes sense. So I think that like understanding these histories, it's very important. But I will say that in terms of, yes, exactly, ethnic studies is very important. And I think that the other thing that is very helpful is just if this is an issue you are interested in at all, I honestly think that, like working in the spaces that are trying to fight the disinformation or trying to research the disinformation is like the best way to really get to understand it more and even apply some of the things you might learn on an organizational level or a research level to your own lives if this is an issue you're facing in your own family and your own community. For example, I think through the work I've done for Xinsheng Project, I've connected with so many amazing aunties and uncles who are progressive and who have been fighting this disinformation battle much longer than we have, and often not even in the United States. For example, on WeChat in particular, there's 1.5 million users in the US, but 3 million in Australia. And there is a whole team of Chinese Australians who are trying to combat disinformation, study it. And so I think learning from those like organizers essentially was really awesome. The last thing I'll say is there is actually an academic article that really I think helped. It's something we kept referencing when we're trying to explain the issue of disinformation within specifically the Chinese diaspora and the Chinese American diaspora to people outside of it, which is this article by the Columbia, I believe, journalism school. They have a center that studies a lot of things relating to disinformation. So this study, the Tao Center, I would recommend that in general as a place if you are interested in thinking about how disinformation impacts marginalized communities.
Nick, do you want to jump in and answer the question, or should I open it up to the audience to see if anyone else has other questions?
I feel like I feel like I've spoken my piece. So everyone has said really great things.
Does anyone from the audience want to unmute and ask a question for our panelists? Otherwise, I think my team has a couple of other questions from people.
Jumping in with one anonymous question. One thing that hasn't come up a whole lot is TikTok. So just wondering if there are any specific challenges that arise from that platform.
If no one else speaks on this, I feel bad, but I can start. For the Chinese diaspora, because TikTok originally first became popular in China, right, as Douyin, and it's still very popular. A lot of disinformation does spread through that, especially because something that's happening on WeChat now is that a lot of people like to share TikTok or Douyin videos on there. And so something that we've been trying to do is create our own videos as well as just like essentially putting out different short form videos that provide a fact-checked alternative perspective. I think one reason why it's gotten so big is it is shorter than YouTube. It is so short, right? And so with our attention spans decreasing, especially as we're constantly on our devices during the pandemic, I think that's led a lot of people to even potentially find YouTube not captivating enough for them. So they turn to the shorter form. But inherent with a shorter form also means that there's very little nuance in most of these videos, right? There's like no sourcing. And usually like maybe someone says like a hot take, but never really explains it. But if you hear enough of those hot takes, then that just cements in your brain as fact. And so I think that that is unfortunately what is happening, as we have seen at least within the Chinese diaspora, of the effects of TikTok. A lot of these hot takes that most people would maybe not bat an eye at, but once the TikTok algorithm has recommended it to you 50 times over the course of a month, maybe you will finally believe it.
Yeah, for our community, we haven't seen TikTok be as much of a force, particularly with older Vietnamese Americans, but if anyone has seen otherwise, I'd love to hear about it. With regards to kind of long form versus short form content, the University of Washington is working with us on understanding the Vietnamese American community, the Center for an Informed Public. And one of the questions we have for them is how this like YouTube content is consumed, because we suspect it's a replacement for talk radio. It's not actually people sitting for an hour, but just turning it on in the background and listening to it while they do other things. And so that's why it's kind of meandering and very much more like talk radio than it is like a TV news show.
I gotta be honest, I'm not an expert when it comes to TikTok. I don't have much to add, but yeah, apologize for that.
Alrighty, thank you everyone for your response. I think we will be transitioning to a breakout room with everybody where we'll do a short activity. We're gonna prompt the audience here with a couple of statements, and you'll either move a sticky note to agree, disagree, or somewhere in between. And we would like to open this up to discussion, but if you're not comfortable sharing, we absolutely understand as well. So I will put the link to the Jamboard here in the comments, if everyone could get that opened up. And I think Raul will be breaking us up very shortly. Glad everyone was able to participate, and hope that everyone had a great discussion with those statements here. So kind of to close off today, I'd like to ask the panelists, what's one reflection that you got from today's conversation?
I can go first. I guess I can share more than one reflection? Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
I guess like my first one is just the love that we the folks have shown here, and just being here, it's exciting. And I think through the Jamboard, it really shows how pervasive and invasive disinformation has been in all of our lives. And I feel the love that we're here and we're trying to work on this together. The second reflection I just feel so thankful for A3 and but also like being in the same panel as Nick and Sunny, like just a giants in their work. So and I just want to give them just another shout out for all their awesome work.
I can go next. Darren, you're a giant too in your work. I really appreciate hearing all the like theoretical research frameworks that I think that I don't really get to hear a lot of, because so much of the work that I do is kind of in the weeds on like grassroots things and not really thinking about the larger picture. So I think hearing a lot of the input that you had, as well as Nick, about thinking more theoretically about, like, for example, like why do these tech companies want to promote a lot of these disinformation echo chambers, and like what profit motivation they have. I think that that was something that is always really great to reconsider, is just the larger concept. I think I saw in the chat a lot of folks talking about how it reminded them so much about the social dilemma, and I totally agree. And I almost wish, you know, there's a lot of Asian Americans working in Silicon Valley, like maybe we need our own version of social dilemma, talking about disinformation within our communities. And also agree with you, Darren, it's been really amazing seeing the care that y'all have for our communities. I think in my small group, as well as hearing a lot of people in the chat, it seems like folks are really determined to continue speaking with and having these tough conversations about politics with their family and their community, and going about in very creative ways to do so, even if it requires some sort of charade sometimes. You don't know the exact terminology in your parents' or your grandparents' language.
Yeah, I agree with everything that everyone's been saying. Really just in awe of all the other panelists, as well as all the participants asking really great questions. I think for me to end on kind of a high note is that a year ago, I wasn't involved in activism at all. And to help start a project that has had dozens of volunteers join and really give their all, and really, you know, people that were very intimidated and afraid to speak out because they wanted Thanksgiving dinner to go well, really giving a voice to people that aren't at our dinner tables, I think has been really inspiring. And I'm like so proud to be part of this movement and with these people that I never would have met any otherwise. So it's just really great, great to see. And just another reiteration that, like, I really feel like, you know, something has changed. Something has been awoken in our community, and it's been really great to see.
Well, thank you so much to our panelists for taking the time out to talk with us today. If you have anything you'd like to plug to the group, please feel free to. Otherwise, I think my team would like to get a group picture. So whenever we're all ready for that as well, we can do a screenshot of all of us on the screen.
I'll just quickly plug our website. We have rebranded. Like I briefly mentioned, this is essentially Tencent, the company that owns WeChat. We used to be called the WeChat Project. We're threatening to sue us, so we changed our name, and everything is, we have like a really difficult rebranding process, but now we are Xinsheng Project, which if you don't know Chinese could be hard to spell. So I just dropped the link to our website. Feel free to follow our work, subscribe to our newsletter, follow us on social media. And I think most importantly, y'all are all really amazing. We have lots of folks who aren't necessarily Chinese on our team. And if anyone wants to come join us, we're always looking for volunteers as well as folks to fill in leadership positions. So if you go to the About and then Join tab, that's where you can fill a form and we will be happy to welcome you in.
I don't really have much to plug on my end because TMC, we do a lot of more back-end work and in support of organizations. But I do want to say that really, if you haven't already, check out the Xinsheng Project and the Viet Fact Check. I actually, when I speak with my parents, I have linked articles from Xinsheng Project. And I'm like, please check this out. And when I talk to folks about like good ways to approach disinformation, and how to kind of push back, I've actually shown them articles from Viet Fact Check. I'm like, this is actually how you do it. Like, this is how you don't repeat the stuff. And this is, you know, they're really good practices. So highly recommend checking them out. They do amazing work. Yeah.
Awesome. And I did plug in Viet Fact Check's website there in the comments. If everyone's comfortable turning on their cameras, if not, that's totally okay. But I'm going to take a screenshot here. So everyone smile on 1, 2, 3. Awesome. Thanks, y'all. And I think with that, we are all done. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Really means a lot to us, for everyone that show up and have such great conversations. And we look forward to the next time. Thanks, everyone.
Cool. Thanks. Bye, y'all.
Bye. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.